Ron was discussing the original sale of the Bechorah and how odd it was that it had to come out through what you would think would be the violation of two mitzvos, well, two averos, losachmod and ona'a. Losachmod in the sense that Esav had shown no interest in selling, and Yaakov talked him into it, like it wasn't on the market, right? And that kind of wanting something and manipulating the other into giving it to you is losachmod, according to everybody. I noted not everybody believes that losach that you could have a prohibition that's an emotion. But everybody agrees that once you act on the emotion, one has violated losach. So that was the first one. The second one is ona'a, which is not only prohibited, but the sale's invalid if one overcharges or undercharges by 20%, which Chazal call 1/6. Because right, so how would the sale even have been? How would the sale even have worked? So right, so Moshe Yehuda brought something which I saw that Ron later brings up, that there were Rishonim before the Ron who said that this was not actually the money of the sale. It was the Adashim was sharing a meal to finalize the sale, more the role of a handshake than the actual purchase. So that's one possible answer. But that's really where we're sitting at. And since we're talking about Drashas HaRan, the Hashkofa Sefer, this that is framed as Drashas as opposed to Drashos as a way of understanding the text, the question that the Ran should be focusing would be, why was it necessary for us to obtain the Bechorah through such a medium? Right? Like on a hashkafic level, not on a understanding the sale level. But like, why was this, what does this mean about the role of the Jewish people, the relationship between us and Edom, etc. So that's where we were last. And from there, I'm going to remember to share my screen this time. Okay. And now bring your face. Okay. So from there, we're now up to paragraph 36 as numbered in Sfaria. Sheyishiv zeh, what this explanation is going to do, who Masha Amru Rabbeinu Zal b'Bava Basra, it's what Chazal say in the Gemara, in Bava Basra, she'oso ayom meis Avram. So he wants to build his explanation on the Chazal that says that what was going on the day of the sale was that Avram had just died. Ubi shel Yaakov adashim, why was Yaakov making lentils? Why was Yaakov making lentils? Libaros esa evil. So he was doing it as it's part of the morning ritual, is to have round foods. Nowadays we do hard boiled eggs. In their culture, the round food, one of the round foods at least, was lentils. Esav lafia nira lo haya b'ptiras Avram klal. So where was Esav during all this? Esav was hunting. So Esav apparently was not involved in Avram's passing at all. Lo dima eino lamoso. He didn't shed a tear over his passing. Lo nishbar libo le'evel Yitzhak. And for all of his pretense of being kibud avaim, when Yitzchak was in mourning, it didn't make him feel bad. He wasn't brokenhearted over the fact that his father was in mourning. He had no empathy for his dad. Aval ba alehem kechaser leiv buzadrachav. He came to them like, you know, like somebody without a heart, heartlessly, right? In an embarrassing manner, but I mean a marinership that would bring on him embarrassment. And he was busy, following his silliness in the field. Even when he happened to go home, and Yaakov was busy taking care of his father. Lo hesev aleha kemishpat lanudu l'nachim. He didn't, sit there as is appropriate, right, to bring Menachem Aval. Havolamar keder chazolim. He said like the light people. Rabbi Simon's off his carousers. What?
Gluttons.
I thought it was more the people who don't take anything seriously than gluttony.
But you're thinking from Zelusa. I'm thinking from like Zayla Vaseve.
I hear. Al itaini nam in hadom hadom hazeh. Pour for me some of this really red stuff. Ki ayeh fanochi, because I'm tired. Al kein karashmo Edom, and that is why he's called Edom. Kolomar, as if to say, eftach pi ushfoch harbe lesocha, open my mouth. I will open my mouth and you pour a lot into it. Kamo Shishaninu, the way we learned, Ain Ovsimasagamo Ella Mal Itimoso. You don't bring a camel to the trough. You pour his food down for him. Kamosha because of Rashi's out. So the words in the brackets I copy and pasted out of Rashi. Ubiroso Yako. And when Yaakov saw that he was demeaning his father in such a strange way, that is when he became a kanoi, he became a zealot. That a great zealot, that Esav should not be getting more of Yitzchak's honor than Yaakov. Ki kvoda b'chor al atzair hu mitzad heyosa av mischakev nirsham yoser alav. Why does the younger son have to respect the b'chor? Because a father leaves a bigger imprint on the b'chor. Right? Because when the Bechor is being raised, there are no other kids in the way. Also, you make all your mistakes on your Bechor. Sorry, Rafi.
I can attest to that too.
He who reishiso
the Bechor, I have the Bechor myself.
He who reishiso, oh no. Right? So. I got distracted because I was thinking that when Yaakov ends up naming Binyamin Ben Oni, does he mean oh no in this sense or in the sense that we normally assume? So anyway, that's why I was distracted. Mm-hmm.
I always learned it as the point being that it was ambiguous when Rachel uh-huh. And then Yaakov was like, no, I want a name which is unambiguously positive.
Okay, so right. So I had not realized that it was anything but child of my pain. And therefore I didn't or child of my suffering. And therefore when the light bulb just went on this second, my head went off in another direction. And for this, the younger son is obligated to respect the older son. Moshe Dershu Rabbi Zinazal, like Chazal saying Ksuvos, Ba'achrei, in the footnote. Okay, but we don't need to look at that. Ba'achrei Heyos Esav Mekaleh Avosav. So once Esav was demeaning, making his father's light, demeaning his ancestors, Eich Yisham Kvodam Bo Yoser Miyakov. How would it be possible for their kavod to be more, to leave a bigger roshem in him than it would in Yaakov? Ulizeh Amar Yaakov Leisa Verosoro Amasav. And this is, it was about this that Yaakov was talking to Esav when he saw his evil, how evil his actions were. Achreya Sharani Ma'alev Osayal Rosh Tifarti. Right, I raised my ancestors, my fathers, to the top of my glory. And just as today, I am more connected to them than you are. Sell today your bechora to me. Our connection to our father in the future will be like it is today. It's not appropriate that all day you smell the smells of the field, or you smell all day like the smells of the field. And I walk in my ancestors' footsteps. And yet, whenever you feel like it, you make yourself great by saying your father's name is more, is more on you than on me. So if you notice here, he is continuing what he said earlier, that where was I going with this? Yeah, that the Edom, that the big mistake Esav made is this idea that he thinks that his position is inherited. And therefore, he didn't understand, right? This was at the very beginning of Drasha Beis. The Edom didn't understand that the role of Yisrael had to be earned, had to be somebody capable of doing it. And therefore, Esav always thought he's the Bechor. He has the same father, the same mother. Not like B'nai Keturah or Yishmael. And, he has the same lineage, and therefore, as a Bechor, he'd be the leader. So here, the whole point of bringing in the connection to Avram's death and Yitzchak being in mourning and the Adashim are for the mourning is to highlight that Yaakov was the one who was actually carrying on the teachings of Avram and Yitzchak, and Esav was ignoring them. So Yitzchak was only asking for a formalization of the reality that already was. Right? Esav wasn't acting as a Bechor because Esav wasn't carrying on the father more than the other sons were. Other son was. Steven, you look confused or just okay. Okay. I didn't think it was one of his harder points. Esav his bonein batmo. Esav was thinking to himself, "Mimaseu asher bacharbo," of the actions, the way of acting, the behaviors that he chose. Vamar, and the pasuk says, "Vayomer Esav, hine anochi oleich lamos lama zeli bechora." I'm going to die. Why do I need this chora? In Yano Shatovim Yehu Lolam Bederech Avosei Hatovim. What the meaning here, right, is that the good people follow the footsteps of their virtuous, the good ancestors. Kamo Shamru Rabbi Seinuzal, like the Gemara says in Erechin, Lolam Al Yaniach Adam Umnus Avosav, which is not exactly the words of the Gemara, which if you're curious, I can put it aside. But I think the Ron has it close, gets the same point. B'chol zeh sheyiyeh nikra shem avosav alav, and anyone who has, who puts his father's name, you know, who wants to be, you know, who wants to be, invoke his father's reputation. Umapeya umiteva haholech shalo b'derech avosav. And so the way of somebody, the nature of somebody who doesn't follow the way of his father's, in Yanova Hefech Shiyishkiya Cheshimam Ad Kima Yavid Zichram. They cause their name to be forgotten until like their memory is totally gone. Lizet Omar, and this is what Esav means when he says, Hine Anochi Olech Lamus. That I'm going to die. Lo b'charti lechet b'derech avosai. I didn't choose to walk in the way of my fathers. Asher tifartam lo sheves bayis, whose glory is to stay at home. Aval havti liyos lamud midbar, midbar. Holech al nafshi al. So I like to walk by myself, you know, like pass by the lion's den to go hunt my hunt. What point is there to have my ancestors' names, you know, to pick up to play up their reputation, to have their names called on me? I don't have the lifestyle they had. So he doesn't make it like Rashi does. I'm going to die. Why do I need the Bechora? Because it won't help me personally. He's saying, I'm going off in a different direction. I'm risking my neck, right? I got ancestors who were bookish. I don't live the life they live, right? And therefore, like, I don't need the Bechora because I don't need the chain of I'm not part of the chain of connection. I'm a different kind of person than they were. Yaakov ra'a, or Yaakov saw, k'michiras ha-bechora levashto uchlimaso, that the selling of the bechora would be Esav's shame and humiliation. Ulezeh omar yishav ali kayom. And therefore he said, swear to me like today. Lo ratza zeh l'man yesar. He didn't do this to prohibit Esau from reneging out of some fear of his life. Come on, why would Esau care about breaking a oath? So the oath was not, you know, because that way he gets some kind of guarantee. Like the Gemara says in Baba Basra, Shechamisha Averos Avar Esav Bo Bayom. Esav committed five sins that day. Umiklalam Shekafar Beikar, and among them that he denied the essence of the faith. So I want to point out something about this day. There's something very significant about the day because, Where's the both Esav and Yaakov refer to Kayom? Where's the first one? I don't know. Okay. Ishavali Kayom, right? Swear to me today, right? Oh, where was the Ron going? Never mind where I was going. So right, Hamisha Veros. So Amar of Yochanan, over here in the corner. Let me bring it to the middle. Hamisha Veros Avaroso Rasha Biyoma Boso Ayom. He committed five sins that day. Bal Nama Rasa. He had relations, or he raped a girl who was already betrothed. Vaharagas Hanefesh, he murdered. Kafar Biikar, He denied the essential of the faith. Kavar b'tchias ha-mesim. Right? He denied the resurrection. B'shatal ha-bechora. And he spit on the, he belittled the firstborn. So among the things that he committed was kafar b'ikar. So if Esav that very day denied the existence of a creator, then what's the big deal about swearing in God's name and then breaking the oath? Avaliyos roa Yaakov makom ha'iror b'dvar ha'locha ha'mechira. Yaakov saw that there was a flaw, something that could be used to contest, to fight the sale. Ki b'choras of ki Yitzchak lo yishakel kesef b'chira. Because obviously, the b'chora of a father like Yitzchak is priceless. And therefore, he wanted through Esav's oath to establish the sale. So he didn't do it because he didn't think it wasn't that he thought that the oath would prevent Esav from questioning the sale, because Esav doesn't believe in God. So what exactly would he be swearing in that would be binding to him? But if Esav were to contest the sale, right, he's bound by the oath, so he'd lose the court case. Gam ki mishpateyo umos ad hayom l'chazik kinyanim. Even today, it is the secular law that you do things to formalize and strengthen the sale. Where the sale has some weakness in the transaction, so even in secular courts they'll make an oath in order to strengthen the sale. So then the Chumash goes on that Yaakov gave the bread and the lentils, the lentil porridge, to Esav. Besamach menavsha, when he was very happy, lamashamile kerso. Esav was very happy that his stomach was now full. Ubiza bechora, and therefore he belittled the birthright. Begam acharei lechto, even after he left, lo no nichem al sichlaso. He didn't suddenly go, oh, I'm full now, you know, I'm off in the scene, and now he has buyer's remorse. He didn't regret his foolishness. No buyer's remorse for us. So, lomar. Maasisi. He didn't regret his foolishness and his wickedness to say, oh my God, what did I just do? But who omro, and this is what he says, see, even after he ate, drank, got up, and left, Esav insulted the Bechora. It wasn't just the eating and drinking, it's the way he got up and left. Even after he left, he was still belittling the Bechorah. V'zehu shalom matzanuhu misonein alea klal. Ki im b'tzira of tulunas habracha. We never find him regretting the act until it becomes attached. You know, when we get to the story of losing the bracha, then he goes, oh, two things now. But until the second thing came up, he had no problem with losing the Bechora. Shomar al espes chorasi lakach. Back later then, he says, you know, achi kara shemo Yaakov. I'm in the corner now. V'yekveni zeb hamayim. It was great that you named him Yaakov. He tricked me twice. Yekveni zeb hamayim. Es bechorasi lakach. He took my right as firstborn. V'hinei atah lakach b'chasi. And now, he is buying my, he took my bracha. Vayomer haloa tzalta li bracha. And then he says, didn't you save some bracha for me? But the thing is, for decades, or however long it was, he expressed no remorse about selling the bechora. And then only because it's icing on the cake for losing the bracha, he mentions the bechora at the back, you know, much later. Hashem ben Folal of Tluna al Salibo Gilgal Akol. So once he had a complaint, then everything got tied up. Mitzuraf ki az ikir shakesha shel Yitzchakim toldosav. In addition to this, what did he do? He saw that that Yitzchak has a connection. He saw the value of the connection that Yitzchak has with his descendants. Davar rav herech ma'od, something great of great value. Im v'rachav Yerushu ha'aret, because those he blesses will inherit the land. Mekulalav yikaresu, and those he curses will cease, will be, you know, kares, will be cut off. L'zeh da'ag al ha'bechora, and therefore then he regretted the bechora. Mitzuraf ki be'esahi haya ben shishim shon of Yotzer. So at that point in time, he was, what, 60 years old or more. V'kasher buzz aleha haya na'ar chaser lev ben chameshas reishana. And when did he make fun of the Bechorah? That was back when he was less than 15 years old. Or no, he was 15 years old. Lizan buzz aleha v'natna b'nezid adashim. And then he made light of it. He belittled it. He ridiculed it, and gave it for the price of a bowl of soup. Obekesef malay, or in full payment. Lonis parasha kasev kedivrei Omer Cain. That the pasuk doesn't say explicitly, like those who say so, as much. And that was, Moshe is not here, but that was where I became aware that he must have known the Rishonim, that he was clearly referring to the Rishonim that Moshe Yehuda quoted last time. Because they say that he paid full price, it's just not in the pasuk. Mikol makom, ech shayiyah ha'inyan ba'al ha'seder, v'yakov asa'aroi al derech shepirashti. In which case, everything is understood as being in order, and Yaakov did what was appropriate according to the lines I explained. So according to this, the idea that he opened with, the idea that Edom was doomed because Esav didn't understand what it meant to carry on the tradition, he thought genetics was enough, is the whole story of the, is reiterated in the story of the Bechorah. Right? He lost the Bechorah by not following in the footsteps of the fathers. So in that sense, he lost being the Bechor as an emotional sense, an amido sense. And therefore, he really shouldn't have possessed the Bechora in the commercial physical sense. Cup is empty. The Imkolze. So with all this, ain't so fake, it's, you know, without a doubt. Shekasher Heshiv Esav Inyan Elibo. When Esav thought about it to himself later, Vesara Me'elav Ruach A'u'im or O'im Avo'im. I tell you, his diktuk is a bunch of he uses constructions, you know. Give me a Rambam who, like, you know, speaks modern Hebrew almost, right? But either way, he got the shorish is dizziness. He got a share beitato, right? He was confounded. He was made confused by vertigo, by a dizzying spirit. Shatam al es Yaakov al zeh. So he hated Yaakov for it. Ki kamosha hutbeu hachim al hativim menagdim mamshichim miyot ha'ach. Sorry. Ki kamosha hutbeu hachim. Like the nature of the brothers, al tivim, where the brothers were given natures, minagdim, that opposed each other, mamshichim miyot ha'achva. So it generated a very little, you know, no love lost, v'rov sinah, and lots of hatred, ki nimshichu ma'aseihem, as their actions continue this. Makniim Esav Yaakov, that Esav became jealous, contemptuous of Yaakov. Ki im heyos asher Yaakov lo pal, v'asa ki im masheroi lasos. Even though Yaakov didn't do anything that wasn't appropriate. Not appropriate to do, that wasn't appropriate for the situation. Im kolze darkov masav im esav bo b'inyan asher kamad afilu basar hames yargish. Still, even though it was appropriate for the situation, it's the kind of thing that even a dead person almost would feel. Urefraim yicholulu, and the ghosts would shake. Afki margiz aretz keisav, and how much more a man who, you know, a world shaking man like Esav. So even though ruach ifim, thank you for the, you knew the Yeshayahu, or you just fast at Google.
Just searched for the phrase.
Okay. So that explains though but in general, I mean, like amitiim. You know, his Hebrew is very his. Not his Shorashim. His Shorashim are generally familiar once I can figure out the Binyan. His Binyanim are not the easy one. But what he's not doing apologetics here. In other words, he explains how what Yaakov did was appropriate given who Esav was. So Esav wasn't carrying on Yitzchak's torch. So therefore, it was appropriate to take the Bechorah away and keep it for somebody who would. So that makes sense. But still, we're not going to pretend that it looked that way to Esav, and the way he behaved didn't logically create hatred in Esav. So again, if we look at the three iterations of the same story that he spelled out, right? In the iteration of how they were born, their natures were created differently so that Yaakov and Esav would hate each other. And now the situation is such that even when Yaakov does what would objectively be the right thing, subjectively, there's no way Esav could take anything but offense. So it's not that, right? It's just they're two different people. They're overly different people. I'm starting to say two with two O's. They're overly different people, and therefore they just can't get along. Beprat Dvar Inyan HaBechora, and in particular about the sale of the Bechora, Im Heyos Sheyakov Titehu Vayifas, if Yaakov encouraged him and he took the encouragement. He seduced him into the sale. It was really what Pitehu would be to me. And he accepted the seduction. We call Makom Kvar Hiskin Bo Mi Daito. In any case, he did at the end of everything accept it of his own of his own mind. Utlunaso Lenafsho Vichamaso Al Atmo. And he had, right, who should he be complaining about? Who should he get angry at? Himself. Well, Devar HaBechora, Yikane Yoser Ma'od. Devar HaBerocha, Yikane Yoser Ma'od. But in the episode of the bracha, when it came to the bracha, right, he, you know, this is a totally different kind of jealousy and anger. Mi yuchal she'eso, who could possibly calm him? Shachar she'esav kiva litbarach mipi aviv. Once Esav intended to be, to get himself blessed by his father's mouth, Asher Oruhu Bezeh, which he himself woke up, awoken in Yitzchak to do. Lo Shenisorer Me'atzmohu, it wasn't from himself, but Yaakov Yikach Bechora Rirchaso. Yaakov came and snatched, took it away. Zed Dover Meknemod, this is something that is incredibly, you know, strife-causing. Mishlach Madanim Benachim, sowing discord between brothers. So the buying of the buying of the Bechorah is an understandable difference in perspective. Right, Yitzchak is looking at who's carrying on the tradition, and Esav is still taking the assumption that, you know, it's mine by right of birth. But the bracha was something that Esav, you know, the dynamic is different. It's not, you know, Yaakov convinced Esav this is what's best for everybody, right? Esav started it, and Yaakov came in without. He stole it. He didn't trick Esav. He didn't get Esav to agree to it. It wasn't like he manipulated Esav. It's just he did it despite Esav. So this is two steps. He's now spelling out that there were two steps in how Yaakov and Esav diverged. And those two steps are going to be significant because, right, his whole point is that this is a foreshadowing of Galus Edom. Imsha inyan zar ba'atzmo tzarich yishuv. And this strange thing about the bracha really does need to be explained. So we tackled the bechorah. We said the bechorah was, you know, a problem between objective reality and Esav perception of what was going on. But now the bracha, it also needs some explanation. Kilo yimaleit me echad mishnei panim. You can't escape the dilemma. There are only two possibilities, right? Im shalo haisa berchas Yitzchak ki im bedemus nevua pshuta. So what's the first one? The first one is that the bracha was nevuah. It was a form of nevuah. Magedet asher yikre levanim, which tells you what will happen to lebanim ha'ile, to these sons, b'achris ha'yamim, in the end of days. V'kishati ha'nefesh Yitzchak klal einanote le'echad mishnei ha'banim. Then Yaakov's soul is not necessarily leaning toward one son or the other. Rotze b'tzik naso mispala lalav. That he was, that he wanted him to be the one fixed and prayed for. In other words, if the bracha, if we take this first horn of the dilemma, and we say that that Yitzchak's bracha was a kind of nevuah, then it's not that Yitzchak was trying to help one or the other; it's he's announcing God's plan. So Yitzchak is not the instigator of the bracha. He's just a conduit for saying what's going to happen. So then the purpose of the matamim, of the food that Rivka prepared or that Esau was supposed to have prepared, was not to make Yitzchak love that son who prepared it. He's kaveh leit palel al toalah, so that he should pray for his welfare. Aval kedei shetuchan nefesh Yitzchak l'sached bo ad shetagid lo asidosav. Or rather, to ready the you know, there's a rule in general. Well, we're about to see the rule, but there's a rule in general that a navi has to be in a proper state of mind in order to get the nevuah, right? So the purpose of the matamim was that Yitzchak's soul would be unified enough with the divine to get the future. Although here, that's the way I read it, but here it seems to be saying unified with the son he's going to give the nevuah to tell the son that future. Al derech masha ana hanar l'shol, but like the way the child in replied to shol, for Yosef hanar lanos is shol. This is not in the quote. The child continued to respond to shol. Vayomer hine nimtza v'yadi reva shekel kesef. Hey, I happen to be holding a quarter of a shekel of silver. Nasati li shalokim, I gave it to the man of God. V'higid lanu es darkenu, and he told us where we're going. Oh, he will tell us where we're going, right? So ukmo shamar Yeravam leishto, or like Yeravam said to his wife in Melachim, v'lakacht biyadeich, he's taking your hand, asara lechem, 10 loaves of bread, 10 breads. The Nikudim, I don't know what Nikudim are, and the translation of cracknels doesn't help me, but obviously it's an edible. Bakbuk dvash and a bottle of honey. Uvasei love, and you should go to the Navi. Hu yagid lecha mayi elanar, he's going to tell you what's going to happen with the child. Chalila she'yezeh char ha'navi nevuaso, and don't you dare think, chas v'shalom, you would think that this is some kind of payment for his nevuah. Aval ma'ashe achashvehu bohu. But my understanding is that this is it. Ki kasher lo tavo aruach me'ez halokim l'navi me'atzma. The spirit of nevuah doesn't come from God to the navi on its own. Ela yitztarech ha'navi l'chazar aleha. The navi has to go seek it. Lo susag ki'im. So what does he have to do? He has to conquer all his natural aspects, his natural desires, hativim kulam, all the natural stuff, so that the soul will be in unity. And we'll be able to grasp the hidden thing. And a person who's caught up in their physicality, the physicality holds it back. I do not remember. Well, let me read the post. Let me read the sentence and see how my memory is jogged. Base halachmu efsher shetasig nefesh is bodidus atzarech laze benigud teva amatzi. Base halachmo, a time when it's eating, when it's being fed, from the word lechem. I had to get further to remember if it was lechem or mochama. Efsher shetasig nefesh. His bodidus, the nefesh cannot reach his bodidus. Hatzarich lezeh benigud teva hamatzik. In what's it called? In opposition to the calling of nature, or the nature that calls. Ulezeh yitzarech sheyikabel hanavi davar nirtza itzal teva, and therefore the Navi has to get something that his physical side, that his natural side wants. Today she ask him be spoon to do the yasir may ache. May ache. He has to it will leave the oppression. So you have to kind of bribe your physical side. You have to satisfy your physical side. But he uses it more of a language of a bribe. Bribe it to shut up and leave you alone. Valderech Sha'amar. Notice here he quotes the Zohar, which is kind of interesting. Tenu shohad l'samael. Go bribe Samael. V'nira shahoyu noagim ha'nevim b'zeh. It would seem that this was the normal way of Nevi'im. Ad sha'amar, v'yomer amatzi al Amos, amatzi says to Amos, Chose, that's his title, Leich barach lecha el eretz Yuda, go run away to Judea, v'echol sham lechem, v'sham tinabei, go eat bread, and then go have your prophecies there. Klomar sham tikach doronos lisnabei. There you will get payments, you'll get gratuities to do your nevuah. Lezem matzu makom l'shekreim nevia sheker. This is where the false prophets have their place to do their lying. Ajeilochim b'farheskiyot char nevuah, so that they actually take a full payment for their prophecies in public. Moshamar kasov, like it says in Micha, Lu ish holech ruach misheker. If a man were walking, in spirit or maybe wind because it's fake, misheker lies. Where was I? Itef lecha yayin. I will preach to you wine, l'shechar, l'yayin, for wine, l'shechar, for booze, v'haya matif ha'om hazeh. And he could be the leader. He could be the leader of such of these people. So Micha and Yeshaya, who lived at the same time, lived in a generation that had more false prophets than real ones, who were more willing to listen to their false prophets than the real ones. And so Micha decries these Nevi'im who, like, go give me money and I'll tell you whatever you want. And they end up leading the nation. Bilulo haya noagim kain. If they weren't, it didn't act Nevi'a emes. If real Nevi'im didn't act that way, kvar hayim mit parsein, pachzuz v'shakruz, Nevi'a sheker. So then the greed and the falseness of the false Nevi'im would have been obvious. We're going to leave it for now because this isn't where we want to discuss prophecy. But, you know, it was in context, so I wanted to explain it because I thought that you'd be a little confused by how alien it is. So the first approach before his detour was that the purpose of Yitzchak asking Esav to bring him Mat'amim was because a Navi needs this. He needs his body to be satisfied if he's going to be able to meditate and reach the prophetic state. That's where he goes with this. And then he brings in proofs and so on. And among the proofs is the fact that while a Navi would ask for food or something to get the yish of hadas, to be able to meditate, to be able to be a Navi, because it was normal for Navim to ask for things, so the Navi Yesheker could now make big bang, because they can now hit up for a lot of money, and no one's going to go, hey, what kind of Navi asks for money? So,
do you think that this is the same thing as... I think it's Elisha asks for music.
I thought so. He may be using more obviously physical music is kind of smell already. They consider like borderline physical, borderline spiritual. So I don't know how he would have, you know, like music is less like blatantly, you know, make the body happy. But it definitely is the same in the sense that you're trying to get to a mental state. And frankly, when your stomach's growling, it's really hard to, you know, the main brain goes back to the stomach. So, you know, let's be happy with a good meal. And then you can start meditating and getting to the Navua. Mikol Makom, in any event, or in any way, Nisparsha Derech HaNeviim Lakachas Aruchama. It's normal for them to take some kind of food. When they want to tell some future. Im shaloyiyeh bohem netiya be'echad mechilkei asid, im latov olara. Even though they have no idea coming in advance whether, you know, before they eat, they have no idea whether they want to, whether the prophecy they want is going to be, you know, im latov im lamutov, sorry. Whether it's for, but either way, right, that they have no sense of what's coming, right? They're asking to get the Nevuah. They're not asking for the food because they want something. A, they don't know the Nevuah is good, and B, they're not making a good future for the person. Even if they were reporting good, they're reporting, they're diagnosing, not causing. They're forecasting, not causing, whatever the right way to say it is. So now, right, we're still trying to explain the first horn of the dilemma. If we say that Yitzchak's bracha was simple prophecy, just telling the future, with no aid to the person that he's talking about at all. No aid of the good. Obviously, knowing the future is useful. Then the food can be explained this way. Vim terze, but if you want. Tachlida inyan v'tomer shahaya l'sameach Yitzchak. That it was there to put Yitzchak in a good mood. Vim neshamu raboseinu zal, shei nevu ashora, Elamitoch Dvar Simcha, because Chazal say that Nevu only happens to happy people. Not too clear how that's different. See, the way I read the whole thing about not wanting the body to distract you, I thought was an element of how to be happy. But he's saying it two ways. He's saying, if you want, you could understand it as, well, they need the physical satisfaction so that they can get into a meditative state. Or if you want, they need the physical satisfaction so that they can be happy, because happiness is part of the prophetic state. I'm not really clear how these two are all that different. When we don't want to be frivolous, we fast on Yom Kippur, you know, I don't see the simcha part and the not wanting distraction part to be as different as the run seems to. Mikol Mako, but whatever the role of the food was, Birchas Yitzchak losi al derech mevarech mispalo. Even though we call it Birchas Yitzchak, it's not in the way of a bracha or davening for somebody. El al derech magid asidus. It's just a way of telling the future. Yeah, merely. And therefore, Yitzchak's merit and his davening doesn't help. So that's the first fork of the dilemma. That's the first way we could have understood the bracha. Vashenihu, what's the second way? Through the merit of Yitzchak and his bracha, sher he morkeves mitfila, v'hagadas atidus, which is both prayer and telling the future. Nisparecha misparach al aderech asher birchehu. The one who is blessed in the way that he is being blessed. Meaning the bracha causes the future. It's not purely telling the future. It's telling the future that the bracha itself is causing. And then the Ran says, "Val kol echad me'apadim kushet chazakos." And either the horn of the dilemma you take, you're going to have a lot of questions. And And I think we'll deal with the questions next week. So this week, what does he do? He goes from the Bechora to the Bracha, which for a dyslexic person is a very distressing paratopic. The Bechora, he said, was a straight, what's it called? Yitzchak knew what the reality was, that Esav had abandoned the ways of his father and wasn't acting like a Bechor, and therefore he didn't really deserve the Bechora. It wasn't really his. The honor that the firstborn gets is a shadow of the father's honor, but the firstborn denies the father's legacy, then there is none of that. But the Bechora, the Bracha is something else. And he sets up two possibilities for what the something else could be. The first possibility is that it's a nevuah. And the whole thing about the food, whatever, in one way or another, is to get Yitzchak to a state where nevuah is possible. The other possibility is that the bracha is more literally a bracha, and it has a causative role in the future. That seems a lot more straightforward, and notice the Ron doesn't spend a lot of time explaining it. But we saw as a teaser for next week, both of those explanations as to what the Bechora is have problems. We're going to need to get to what the Bechora is, because the Bracha and the Bechora, the two stages at which Yaakov and Esav in the second iteration in their lifetimes, their animosity builds, has a lot to do with Golos Edom and the reality we're living through now.